BBOR, Black Box, Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. All right, well, we are continuing onward with our discussion about the Great Zodiac Killer Hoax of 1986 by Thomas Henry Horan. And as you see here, this is listed as Part 8. But if you haven't heard the previous segments, that's fine. You can keep listening. Feel free to stay tuned, because we're just having a discussion about the Zodiac Killer and a very prominent alternative theory out there. Now, as you see, though, if we're going to get right into things, I would say that in the part of the book that I was just going through, I found that this part is starting to heat up. Like, you know how some books kind of give away all of the good stuff in the beginning, and then the final chapters are just filler, just so that they can say they wrote 200 or 300 pages? This is not the case. This thing has slowly warmed up, because in the current chapter that we've been going through, I'd say that there's a lot of things that we have to discuss. But first and foremost, it begins by talking about how Thomas Horan accuses Robert Graysmith of writing in his book Zodiac a theory that is mostly supported upon the idea that the Zodiac murders were committed by one person, as opposed to many different people committing unconnected murders, unconnected killings. And I'd be like, I think it's a little bit more than most of that. It sounds like that's the entirety of Robert Graysmith's theory. I think that would be the heart and soul of most Zodiac theories out there, that there was a single perpetrator. And we've talked a lot about the group murder theory on this channel. I don't deny it, but let's look at some of the harder pieces of evidence. And before we get into some things about Graysmith, I would just like to say something about this here. Let's actually read a little segment from Thomas Horan. By even a stranger coincidence, when Graysmith was attending college in Oakland, local theaters were showing a re-release of a 1961 B-horror film called Bloodlust. Let's pay attention to that title, Bloodlust, a loose remake of The Most Dangerous Game. In this version, the shipwrecked travelers are hunted by the island's lord and master individually as couples uncannily similar in appearance to all of Zodiac's purported victims. So, what do we make of that? According to Horan, there's a 1961 film called Bloodlust that has victims that appear very similar to that of those involved with the Zodiac killings. I haven't seen that film, but that is immediately on my to-do list. I'm going to try and find a copy of that and see if that this provides any clues. Because The Most Dangerous Game is something that has been talked about in a lot of Zodiac theories. And even back when I first heard about the Zodiac Killer as a kid, they talked about how the Zodiac was somebody who hunted people for sport. And we have the very famous first cipher, which we can just read right here. I like killing people because it is so much fun. It is more fun than killing wild game in the forest, because man is the most dangerous animal at all. But dangerous is spelled danger-roo. There's an E at the end in place of an S. Animal of all. To kill something gives me the most thrilling experience. It is even better than getting your rocks off with a girl. The best part is, when they die, I will be born in paradise. Paradise is spelled with a C, and all of them will become my slaves. I will not give you my name because you will try to slow me down. And yes, this thing is filled with misspellings, and we're going to talk about a possible theory that Horan has provided about why the Zodiac Killer has provided so many misspellings in the ciphers and the letters. And it was even a little bit hard to read. I mean, paradise is spelled P-A-R-A-D-I-C-E. And what was that other one? Slow is spelled S-L-O-I. Many misspellings in that. But what the thing, though, is, though, there have been a lot of comparisons about The Most Dangerous Game, and there have been many parodies of The Most Dangerous Game. I had to read that in high school. I don't know about you guys, but it has General Zaroff and that whole thing about how they want to hunt people because they believe man is the most dangerous animal at all. If you're into parodies of The Most Dangerous Game, I highly recommend the stuff from X-Men. Love that stuff. With Longshot and Wolverine, The Most Dangerous Game, that's the one I recommend. But to digress from that, I mean, I'm going to get a copy of this film, Bloodlust. Once again, Bloodlust, 1961, where Horan is saying that there are an enormous amount of similarities in the victims of in that film versus the victims of the Zodiac killing. Let's look out for that, and let's find out if there's any truth. I mean, I think the only way to explore that one in its entirety is to watch the movie. Now, what do we make of the misspellings in the letters? This is some big stuff right here. Because the thing that Horan has presented in this chapter is that the reason why so many words are misspelled, like as you see, dangerous is spelled D-A-N-G-E-R-O-U-E. For many years, I thought, okay, the guy created a cipher and a cryptogram, and it just wasn't perfect. That's all. He made some mistakes when he was writing it out. I mean, we're only human, right? That's what I thought, and I think a lot of people think that too. But the reason why he believes that there are these intentional misspellings is because of some of the things that are written at the bottom. And the final line that is still kind of uncoded, or it has yet to be decoded. It is coded. Why did I say uncoded? Excuse me. And the letters in that are just like, if you look at that cipher, you'll just see a mash of letters at the end. E-B-E-O-R-I-E-T-E-M-E-T-H-H-P-I-T-I. And I swear this one YouTuber thought he had cracked it by saying it's really something that means before me, the thy pity. And I was like, you almost had me there, except the thy pity. But, I mean, when you first look at that, the first word that I thought of was before, even though there's no F. What I heard Horan say in an interview was that it reveals Robert Graysmith, Robert Smith's name is actually in this. And I was like, what are you talking about? Absolutely not. There's not even an S in this thing. How could this possibly reveal Robert Graysmith? But remember what we said about the word dangerous. Dangerous ends in an E. D-A-N-G-E-R-O-U-E. So in this, you can substitute the letters E in S. And he gives this whole little breakdown about how each line can be messed around, and if you can substitute the E and the S, and then you can kind of substitute these misspellings that are found in the cipher, and then it will reveal something. But it doesn't say Robert, it says Robert. Even that is misspelled. And what Horan believes that it's trying to say is that it's going to spell out Robert G. Smith II, because that was Robert Graysmith's birth name. Robert Gray was his middle name, and he was Robert Smith II. His father was R.G. Smith Sr. But even that is misspelled incorrectly. I mean, it's not perfect. And the explanation provided by Horan about why it doesn't actually spell out Robert Graysmith is, it's in case anybody figured it out, Robert Smith had an alibi, he has an escape rope, he has a get-out-of-jail-free card, he can just be like, that doesn't spell Robert Smith II at all. I mean, Robert isn't spelled correctly, and even though his name wasn't Robert Smith II, we just said that don't quote me on that. I was about to say, yes, his real name was Robert G. Smith II. I was about to say he was Robert G. Smith Jr., but don't quote me on that one. But the whole point is, that's the explanation that Horan has provided about why there are these misspellings. It's because they are substitution letters that you can use for that final line of the cipher. That's just the block of letters. It can be decoded by substituting, as we said. E can also represent the letter S, and so on. I mean, I would just like to ask you that as the challenge question. Do you think there's any plausibility in that? Or do you believe that this guy is just completely way off? Because as I said, though, the final, like, decoded message does not reveal the name Robert. Even that is misspelled. That reveals Robet, R-O-B-E-T, and then you also have Emmet, E-M-E-T. I mean, it's like, it's not perfect. It's really not perfect. But there's another thing that is mentioned here in this chapter that we've been going through, and this is a harder piece of information. According to Robert Graysmith, the first time that the Zodiac symbol appeared, that's the circle with the cross going through it, was at Lake Berryessa on September 27th of 1969. But according to Horan, the Vallejo Times Herald printed a life-size copy of their letter, including a famous circled crosshair, otherwise known as the Zodiac symbol, on their front page on August 4th, 1969. In short, the Zodiac used the circle with the cross going through it prior to Lake Berryessa that was mailed in with a letter following Blue Rock Springs. In between Blue Rock Springs and Lake Berryessa, there was a letter with a circle and the crosshairs going through it. And, of course, Horan, with his famous vocabulary, accuses Graysmith of lying and intentionally fabricating that. The reason, Horan writes, for Graysmith lying about this fact is simple. In a later chapter, he claims that the message written on the car door at Lake Berryessa could only have been left by the Zodiac because the Zodiac symbol had never been published in print prior to September 27th of 1969. Well, okay, Horan says he's found the article from August 4th, 1969, and that proves that Graysmith is incorrect. I just want to say one quick note about the handwriting at Lake Berryessa. A lot of people have talked about how they believe the handwriting on the car door at Lake Berryessa is different than the handwriting in the letters. After the Lake Berryessa murder of Cecilia Ann Shepherd and the attempted murder of Brian Hartnell, the Zodiac penned something on a car door. He wrote the dates of Blue Rock Springs, Lake Herman Road, and Lake Berryessa, and the time at Lake Berryessa, 6:30 p.m., and then provided the circle with the cross going through it. The thing about that is that, why is the handwriting different? All I have to say about that is, why don't you write a sentence on a piece of paper with a pen and then write something on a metallic surface, 5 times larger, with a marker, and let me know if your handwriting doesn't look somewhat different. I would say it probably should be different, but we're going to talk about the handwriting in some future uploads, but I just think there should be expected differences between writing 5 times larger on a car door versus writing on paper. But if you want to challenge me on that one, please go ahead. And that's where I think we're going to leave it for now. What do you have to say about any of the material that we've put forward? I would love to hear any comments you would have to say about this. If you like this upload, you can hit the like button. And let's all try and find a copy of Bloodlust and see if there are any similarities between the Zodiac victims and the characters in this film Bloodlust from 1961. So that's going to be the next project, and we can explore that a little bit more. And I think that it's very valuable to see that even if Graysmith just made a factual error about the Zodiac symbol not being printed prior to September 27th of 1969, they could be big points for Thomas Horan. But once again, if you haven't subscribed yet, you're welcome to subscribe. But most importantly, please drop some comments so we can discuss. All for me now. Until next time.